And Lori Wallach is on the line with us. Lori is the executive director of Public Citizens Global Trade Watch. Tradewatch.org is the website, or citizen.org/trade. And you can tweet her at Wallach Lori, L-O-R-I, W-A-L-L-A-C-H-L-O-R-I. Lori, welcome back to the program.
Thank you very much, Tom.
Oh, my. Your audio sounds like you're in the bottom of a barrel. I don't know if we can get your telephone and or your microphone up to your mouth. That would be a big help.
I could just pick up the
Perfect.
Phone. How about that?
There you go. Okay, so Trump has this NAFTA 2, this North American Free Trade Agreement 2. He's calling it the Mexican-American something or other. He renamed it, he rebranded it, and says, this is new and wonderful, and it's going to do great things. You've had a chance to look it over. What do you think?
Well, in a certain way, more important than my opinion is that last week, the United States International Trade Commission, which is an independent government agency that is statutorily required to do an investigation and assessment of every trade agreement before it goes to Congress, they issued their study last Thursday. And what they basically found was a very modest difference would be done by this agreement. And I would say, but for Trump making it sound like it was such a dramatic change, I don't know the ITC study would have gotten much attention at all, because the main attention it got was as an exaggeration. So the ITC found that if the agreement, the modified NAFTA, were fully implemented in 6 years, U.S. GNP, the growth, the wealth of the economy, would be, brace yourself, 35/100 of 1% larger in 6 years.
35/100 of 1%.
1%.
This is what Donald Trump is going to give us with his great negotiating skills.
So, you know, basically, this is smaller than the rounding error of the paperclip budget item in a very small government agency. So the finding basically was would have been negative, but for an assessment that was sort of made up that there was a positive trade gain to be found by freezing in place certain rights for the big online companies. The bottom line of all of it is everyone who has now for a year and a half been saying the agreement that they signed, the agreement as is not going to make the difference we need, but because they made some progress, and there is some notable progress that the ITC begrudgingly includes, it's worth fighting to get the stuff that we really need done. So some of the specific things in the ITC study that were super interesting. So one of the best things that happened in the renegotiation is they got rid of investor state dispute settlement.
Right. This is
the private courts,
okay.
That promote job outsourcing. They got rid of that. And so one of the things the study finds is the positive impact, even though all the corporations are screaming bloody murder about having these special rights taken away, they found there's a positive impact. There'll be more investment in the U.S., less outsourcing. So that was good. But at the same time, the ITC found that the rules that would have less Chinese parts in autos or that might raise wages, they found all of those were negatives. Seriously. The way the study was done, those things that actually are the reason why all the unions and groups like Public Citizen aren't trying to kill the agreement right now, those are the things that they found were a problem. Meanwhile, they found economically good that Big Pharma would have special new monopolies and keep medicine prices high. I couldn't make this stuff
up. This is bizarre. Is ITC a federal government agency? Are they under Trump's thumb?
It's an independent agency, but I would say they've got two big problems. They have historically made grandiose, rosy predictions for all the past trade agreements that have been a catastrophe.
Right.
So just for instance, with China and the China WTO vote that you and I know has led to a ginormous hundreds of billions of dollars trade deficit, they said it would increase the trade deficit by $2
billion. Wow.
Seriously. Wow. So they're always off. But in this instance, I would say what they are doing is they're trying to defend the status quo. And then they basically have such a broken methodology. But the pieces going into the methodology, like finding the benefits of having the ISDS taken out, that's worth looking at. Cut to the chase of all of it. The study came out. It's a really big sort of check-the-box moment in the process. It means now the implementing legislation could be sent to Congress. And what politically it means is we're where we were. The Democrats, the unions, groups like Public Citizen are saying you have to take out the special protections that pharma was allowed to put into the agreement. And you have to add the environmental and labor standards that are necessary to stop NAFTA's ongoing damage by bringing up wages and standards so we don't have race to the bottom outsourcing. Right. That's an agreement that would be worth having. The one they signed last year, not so much.
Right. So these are the things that the Republicans will not do because they would benefit average people and the environment rather than billionaires and polluting industries and the drug companies.
What's a very interesting situation, Tom, is that that's exactly right. And now Trump is in a position where either he's going to have to make those improvements that the House Democrats are insisting on, or the thing won't get passed.
Right.
So Trump basically signed a deal that gave new goodies to Big Pharma and didn't fix the old problems. Mm-hmm. To get the agreement approved and deliver on fixing NAFTA, the only deal that can get through Congress is the one that the Democrats would basically fix. And so he's going to have to choose, given the corporations don't want any changes. There's a multi-million-dollar corporate campaign. The Republicans in Congress want no changes. But the agreement's dead if they don't take out the pharma stuff and add real labor and environmental standards. So stay tuned is what I would say.
Yeah. So he's got to figure out if the PR to him of getting an agreement that he can say whatever he wants about is more important than having an actual good agreement. I think that this is probably a decision that they're going to make based on what kind of publicity they're going to get out of it and what kind of spin they can put on it rather than what's good for America or what's good for the economy.
Well, to some degree, they don't have that option that you just described, though, because they can't get it through Congress. It can't get implemented unless they do the things the Democrats want because the Democrats are majority in the House.
Right.
So it's to some degree, is the president going to be willing to basically make the changes the Democrats insist on that the corporations and the Republicans in Congress oppose in order to get the deal through Congress, and then he'll be sharing some of the credit with the Democrats who made him do the thing he actually didn't do in his own. That's the big question no one knows about, but if we want to maximize the chances that we end up with a new NAFTA that at least starts to stop some of the ongoing damage, it's really important for everyone to pile on to their Democratic members of Congress and insist that they get the medicine, the giveaways to pharma out, and the labor and environmental standards in.
Okay, so
because that is the agreement we need.
Right, so when you call your Democratic member of the House or the Senate at 202-225-3121, what you say is this new NAFTA deal that the Trump administration is negotiating, we want the goodies for the drug companies out of it, and we want labor and environmental standards put into it. Period.
And that the agreement as is, not okay, but there certainly is a changed NAFTA that could help stop the damage, and that's what we're trying to get.
Right.
Because, Tom, it's not like TPP, where if we stop it, there's nothing.
Right.
If we don't replace it, we've still got the damage in NAFTA.
Right.
And we can all do this together.